So honestly, it wasn't very standardized. I would say there was a good amount of variability in how people would approach a fever. Some people would just hear, oh, a temperature is above a certain criteria, and automatically, reflexively say, we should get a blood culture. And everybody, I think, approached it very differently.
So what we really were hoping to do was to take this pre-program perception that tests don't have unintended consequences and make clinicians more aware that a test that is falsely positive can have a negative impact on patients. So after the protocol was implemented, we really encouraged providers to be much more thoughtful about how they approach patients with fever. So if a patient had a fever, it wasn't a reflex order to get a blood culture. It was, let's go through this process to really decide, does the patient need a blood culture? Do you really think this patient has bacteria in their blood, or could there be another very good reason for that blood culture?
People just became more aware of the sheer number of blood cultures that were getting sent from their patients. I don't think we were really realizing how often we were sending cultures, sometimes for multiple days in a row, sometimes for multiple catheters per patient for several days in a row. So one was just the awareness of what we were actually doing and the frequency with which we were doing it. Everybody sort of being more open to the idea that just because a patient has a fever, it doesn't necessarily mean that they need a blood culture. So a fever could be from infection, but it could also be from narcotic withdrawal. So a lot of our patients, as they recover from critical illness, they require sedation medications. As the child gets better, those medicines get weaned. And when you start to decrease those doses, one of the symptoms of withdrawal is actually fever. So not at all an infection, just fever. Part of what we were really hoping to do, and I do think that we were successful to a good degree, is to just remind clinicians that, again, every fever doesn't necessarily mean infection.
So a good example would be a child who had a persistent fever, would get blood cultures every day during their visit. After 4 or 5 days, a blood culture would become positive, not necessarily because the child was any sicker or anything was different. Many of us would suspect that that represented a contaminated blood culture, but because the result was positive, it would lead the team then to draw more blood cultures, order antibiotics, order additional laboratory tests. In some cases, they would remove the catheters that patients had. So there were many downstream, potentially unintended negative consequences of that, in some cases, false positive result.
Blood cultures are not, I think, on a lot of people's radar as a risky or dangerous topic at all. But I do think that there is some unintended harm that we don't realize by thinking about blood cultures sort of not in a thoughtful way. So one, the false positive rate is pretty high. So in our literature review, up to half of the cultures that we send can be falsely positive. So by falsely positive, it may pop up as, oh, there's a bacteria in the blood, and then a clinician will say, my patient has a bacterial bloodstream infection, I absolutely need to put them on antibiotics. And then maybe 24 hours later, you realize, as the lab has sort of identified the bug, that it's just a skin contaminant. It's not actually making your patient sick, but you've given them unnecessary antibiotics. A patient could have an allergic reaction to an unnecessary antibiotic. There are side effects of medications. We worry about antibiotic resistance if we treat unnecessarily and keep giving people antimicrobials when they don't need them. I think the concepts of resistance and antibiotic stewardship are very important here. Our goal was really to help clinicians continue to diagnose the concerning bacterial bloodstream infections in the kids that were really sick with those, and not send unnecessary testing on the children who were at much, much lower risk of a bacterial infection.
The clinicians have been supportive of this. I think the data show that we were able to really impact our whole group. One of the strengths of this program was it was really a multidisciplinary group. We had nursing, we had people from our vascular access team, we had physicians, we had residents, we had other providers. It was a real team approach to how we could evaluate patients and reduce blood culture utilization. We found it very important to include other providers in the ICU, so not just the intensivists, but the oncology doctors, other infectious disease physicians, as well as nurses that bring attention to when patients get sick and may or may not need these tests done. So we found this is an essential example of when you really need to bring together a multidisciplinary or transdisciplinary group of people to solve a common problem.
So it took us sort of a few tries, I would say, to get everybody to be comfortable with the new concepts and the new process. There were two basically parts of the tool. So the first was a checklist that we encouraged all of our clinicians to sort of go through anytime they thought their patient needed a fever evaluation. So instead of, you know, sort of picking up the phone and the nurse saying, you know, hey, the child in room 16 has a fever, would you like a blood culture? We would encourage them to actually work through what we were hoping was kind of a systematic algorithm to decide, you know, the items on the left sort of point me in the direction of, yes, my patient may have a bacterial bloodstream infection and I should get a culture. And then you sort of work through the column on the right and it asks you to think about things that maybe suggest, no, you don't need a blood culture. And it was very important to us that though we wanted the approach to be more standardized and a little bit more protocolized, that we still felt that the autonomy and just the judgment of a clinician was still very important. So it was their call always. And once they kind of work through the...
But people have done this now, they've seen the data, they've learned from this study that we haven't harmed patients. So people feel like this is a good thing. I think we all are moving to a culture of high value care. How can we safely do less? We do a lot of testing, some of it may be unnecessary, and as we start to learn about what we can scale back, we want to make sure that we're doing that in a safe manner for patients. We know the more we use antibiotics, the more bacteria become resistant to antibiotics. So being good stewards of how we use antibiotics will help everyone as we move forward to preserve drugs that are essential for treating patients with infections. One aspect of this project that we found very exciting was the link between diagnostic tests and antibiotic use. When people order tests, they think we need to start antibiotics. We suspect that by reducing the culture, the practice of ordering blood cultures in the unit, we may also have reduced antibiotic use. So I think this has been a success story in that we've been able to safely do less for our patients in the ICU here at Johns Hopkins.